I've always wanted to take one of these at-home DNA tests because I want to learn more about my family's background, and they're super cheap, so I figured, why not?
And I have no interest in these tests. I think it's really creepy for some company to have my private DNA. Either way, at-home tests like 23andMe or AncestryDNA have exploded in popularity. By one estimate, around 26 million people have taken one of these tests.
So maybe I should be worried about my privacy because my DNA is getting uploaded to some database somewhere.
But here's the scary thing. Even if I refuse to ever take one of these tests, my DNA could be at risk too. The reason why starts with a serial killer. Our colleague Rachel explained it to us.
So the Golden State Killer is also known as the East Area Rapist. And in the 1970s and 80s, he raped and murdered people across California.
He was wearing some type of a mask or a hood.
And for decades, investigators just had no idea who he was.
There was some DNA left at crime scenes, but even after decades, investigators couldn't find a suspect. So they had nothing to compare the DNA to. But all that changed in 2018.
So the big breakthrough came when investigators uploaded a genetic profile from the crime scene DNA to this big, huge genealogical database. They didn't find an exact match, but they did find matches to relatives.
Investigators used a method called a long-range familial search to find similarities between the crime scene DNA and a few of that person's third cousins. From there, they can narrow their search way down and look for a suspect within a specific family tree. And they found one.
The answer was, and always was going to be, in the DNA.
Investigators solved the case because of the big DNA database they used, which didn't belong to law enforcement. It's freely available, and the data inside it came from services like 23andMe. An at-home DNA test like 23andMe generally works by looking at spots in your genome called single nucleotide polymorphisms, or SNPs. Each one is a specific location where there are known variations from person to person. Companies make their guesses about your ancestry by analyzing thousands or even millions of SNPs. Populations in Europe, say, are more likely to have one set of variations, whereas Asian populations might have a different set. For an end user like Danush, this is the product being sold. A map of his ancestral stomping grounds.
I got 86.7% Western Asian, which on the map is highlighting like Turkey, Iran, Iraq, that part of the world.
But underneath the UI is the raw data, the log of all those SNPs. That data ends up in a private database owned by whoever sold you the test kit. Now here's where it gets interesting. Investigators working a case have a few options for doing a genetic search. First, they could search through a testing company's private database if they can gain access. Family Tree DNA was in the news recently for actively working with law enforcement. 23andMe says that it won't do that, but there's always the threat of a court order. So that route is tricky. Second, the FBI does operate a national DNA index with around 17 million identified people in it. And some states allow the index to be used for familial searches. But those 17 million people are all arrestees and offenders, so unless the suspect had relatives in the criminal system, it's not much help. But investigators in the Golden State Killer case found a third option. More and more, customers of DNA services are voluntarily posting their genetic profiles on free-to-search websites like GEDmatch, DNAland, or FamilyTreeDNA. This is great for anyone doing genealogy or looking for long-lost relatives. With a few clicks on GEDmatch, you can create an account, upload your DNA profile, and maybe find a bunch of third cousins you never knew about. But it was also great for investigators tracking the Golden State Killer.
So law enforcement used it in a similar way. They took the crime scene DNA, created a fake profile, and uploaded it, and then looked for relatives.
That was the breakthrough. They used DNA info that was freely available. No need for subpoenas or criminal databases. It's just sitting there. But this is where my privacy is at stake. Let's go back to that big web of third cousins. It was used to catch a serial killer, that's great. But instead of crime scene DNA, swap in my DNA. I leave my DNA all over the place. I shed hair, skin cells, saliva. But I've never gotten my DNA sequenced, so I shouldn't have anything to worry about. But through familial testing, if enough of my relatives took tests, I could be identified from a DNA sample just like the Golden State Killer was. Now, I'm not planning on committing any crimes, but there are still privacy concerns for me. First, false positives exist in DNA tests, so I could end up the subject of an investigation by mistake. Or a sketchy insurance company could find a way to correlate some of my genetic data with other medical information and discriminate against me. We asked a genetic privacy expert, Natalie Ram, about these concerns, and she said that the unifying problem is control.
Your genetic data is a link that you share with family members involuntarily. It's not something I've chosen, and it's something I cannot change.
And to up the ante, as databases grow, more and more people will be findable by their hundreds and hundreds of distant relatives.
And then you've got to ask, gosh, how many third cousins do I have? Do I even know who all those people are?
A recent study assigned some pretty surprising hard numbers to this. It predicts that for any population that shares some common ancestry, having DNA from just 2% of the people could make anyone findable via a third cousin or closer. For example, all Americans with some European ancestry could be matched from just a 2% pool. So if free databases get diverse enough, everyone in America could be findable via their genes, which means DNA just won't be anonymous anymore.
The bottom line here is that we are rapidly approaching a place where we have a de facto national DNA database.
For now, lots of people are debating policies that would regulate familial search. One law proposed in Maryland would completely ban familial DNA searches of consumer databases. A more extreme policy could create an official nationwide DNA database. That sounds creepy, but it might be easier to regulate than the de facto system we're headed for. In the meantime, while we debate all these questions, piles and piles of at-home DNA test kits are sold. The database continues to grow, and the genetic dragnet grows too. Hey, so we made this video in collaboration with Vox.com, and Danush has made a companion video that you should check out.
Yeah, so our video looks into how these DNA tests actually work and what they can and can't tell you. So make sure to go check that one out.
Yep, watch it now. It'll be right over there, I think.
Smash that like button.
Gross.